Greetings, my name is Monty Martin, and welcome back to Isadora 101. In this series of video tutorials, I'm going to be showing you the core features and functionality of Isadora 3. Today, we're going to dive in and learn about sound playback in Isadora. We're going to be exploring how you can use Isadora's powerful sound player actor to add sound effects, music, and other audio effects to your Isadora patch that you can use on their own to create a soundscape or alongside your video and other visual images as well. As part of exploring how the sound player works in Isadora, we're also going to be learning about how to use Isadora's triggering system. These are a few other actors that we can use in Isadora to create our own customized parameters which will trigger different things to occur in Isadora. In this case, we're going to be learning how to use these triggers to precisely control when audio files start and stop, but we can also apply triggers to many, many other areas of Isadora, such as activating and deactivating scenes, starting and stopping movie playback, and much, much more. Learning how triggers work will really unlock a lot of the interactive potential of Isadora. So if you are particularly interested in interactive features and using sensors and other forms of control, you'll want to learn the basics of how these trigger actors work today so that you can apply those to much more ambitious projects. Of course, I've assembled a couple audio files that you can use if you want to follow along with me as I'm working to get today, or you can use any of your own audio files as well that you might have created or downloaded from other sources online. I'll have the links in the description below, as well as the attribution for those who created these files in the video description if you do want to check them out for yourself. If you're ready, let's boot up Isadora. Okay, so I've already imported a few audio samples into Isadora right away. I've also got a video file. Today, I'm going to be creating one of my favorite, really basic sort of soundscapes, which is a rain and thunderstorm style scene. So I'm just going to bring in right away, just to give us a little bit of inspiration to get our creative juices flowing, I'm going to bring in this video file of some rain falling, and we'll show my stages. Let's get the video preview right here. Now, this movie file that I'm working with actually doesn't have any audio attached to it. This is one thing to be aware of when you are working with sound right away in Isadora, is that the movie player can also play sound. So if you have a movie file that has its audio already baked right into it, then you can control the volume of that movie player by modifying the volume input on the movie player itself. In this case, the file that I'm working with has no audio whatsoever, so it doesn't matter. But if you are using a video file that does have audio built into it and you want to take that out, it's just a matter of reducing the volume down to zero, and then you're pretty much golden from there. So that is something to be aware of, is that the movie player itself has sound baked into it. But when we really want to get into the precise control of sound playback in Isadora, we also want to use dedicated sound files and the sound player actor. So I'm going to bring in one of my sound files right now and drop it into the scene. I'm going to grab this one here, this InspectorJ's Moderate Rain, and I'm going to just drag it from the media bin into my scene editor. Now, you'll notice that once I did this, we still aren't hearing anything. Nothing's started at all. Unlike the movie player, which immediately begins playing back when it's created in your Isadora scene, the sound player needs to be told to get started and get moving. It doesn't automatically start playing, neither when you add it to a scene, nor when we enter the scene from another prior scene. In order to start and stop the sound player, we need to click this input. It needs to receive something at the start input, whether that is a mouse click like this. Maybe we'll just take the volume down a little bit. Or some sort of input from another actor of some kind to tell it to get started. Similarly, it will automatically stop at the end of the loop, or I can click the stop input to stop the sound file itself. So with the sound player, if we just wanted to start playing immediately when we come into our scene, or we need to get it going right away with the movie file, well, we don't want to have to click it every single time, do we? For an operator running a show, that's a little bit annoying. So instead of doing that, there are a few different ways that we can tell Isadora to hit that start input on the sound player for us or with another trigger. One of the simplest ways to control this is by using our keyboard actor itself. This fun little actor, called the keyboard watcher, watches for a key press in Isadora. All I need to do is add it to my scene, and I plug the key output into the trigger that I want to hit. And now in my keyboard watcher, I can specify which key on my keyboard I want to be the key that I pressed to get this going. By default, it's the A key, but I can click the key range and type open quotes, maybe S for start, and close quotes, and that changes the key that it's going to start with. So now when I press the S key on my keyboard, the sound player starts. Maybe I'll also create another keyboard watcher, and I will set this one. We've already used S for start, so we might not use S for stop. That would cause both triggers to fire at the same time. So I'll use P for the end of stop. And I'll plug that into the stop. And now I have control of this sound player precisely. I can press P to stop it and S to start it again. If I do hit the S key while it's already playing, what's going to happen? It's going to start it over again from the beginning. So just be aware that if you finger that key a couple times in the middle of the process, that actually resets the playback back to the beginning. And that when I stop the sound player's playback, that's going to stop it entirely. That's not a pause button. It stops it completely. But this is going to give me the control of the starting and the stopping of the sound player. Now, this in itself is still a bit of a process. If you think about this, if you think back to how we used our previous tutorials where we learned about creating multiple scenes, if I am going to press the space bar to fire a new scene in Isadora, and then I have to press the S key immediately afterwards to start this sound file, that's pretty irritating. I would like it if it just started immediately on its own when I entered the scene. Well, fortunately for us, we actually have an actor that does that. I'm going to disconnect and delete these keyboard watchers, and I'm going to add a new actor here called Enter Scene Trigger. The Enter Scene Trigger is a very handy little actor to keep in your toolbox, because the Enter Scene Trigger is like a magic robot that at the start of a new scene, it automatically hits a trigger for you. So I can plug it into the start of my sound player, and what I will now do is I will just create a brand new scene at the beginning of my show. I'll drag it to the front, and when I hit the space bar to go from my now first scene to the scene that we'd created previously, the Enter Scene trigger fires right off the top there, and the sound player and the movie player started together at the very start of the scene, the moment it was triggered. This is a perfect way to set up your sound players if you just want basic sound playback. Whether we wanted a piece of music playing alongside this video image, whether we wanted a sound effect to happen or anything like that, using the Enter Scene trigger combined with the start of the scene is the perfect way to do that. Now, I also have a sound here that causes a thunderbolt. And maybe what I'll do in this scene is I will connect that to my keyboard watcher. And now what I've got here is a button. So I both have a button to press A, but I want a thunderbolt. But then I have that rain always playing in the background when I need it. Now you'll also notice here that my rain did stop. Because by default, unlike the movie player, which is always looping, sound playback does not automatically loop. We have to go in here to the loop enable and actually turn that on if we want our sound to loop once it's started. Once you do that, the sound player will loop infinitely once it's started, just like the movie player does. So if we go back to our first scene here, which I will just rename this pre-show, and I will rename this one Rain so that we know. Notice how the start of the scene now, the rain immediately started playing for us. When it gets to the end of this track, it's going to start right back at the beginning again. It's nice soft rain, so we don't really notice the flip over between one or the other. Particularly with looping sounds like rain and things like that that are happening in the background, give them a listen to make sure that they loop nicely for you, because sometimes you can't hear that. And then now, anytime I want to, I can just add those thunderbolts in, and we've got our nice thunderbolts, lightning, sort of storm scene right in there. Pretty simple configuration there, but a really elegant way for creating sound triggers within a scene and making sure that your sound playback works throughout all your scenes as well where you need it. Notice, of course, that when the sound is active, just like the movie players, when we leave the scene, the sound's going to stop entirely. And when we come back into it, it's going to start right away there as well. Now, we can use the play start and the play end to trim the sound that we're playing. You might have heard, if you were listening very, very closely, that that thunderbolt sound that I'm using actually has a few seconds of silence at the beginning. So when I hit the A key to trigger it, it's a bit of a lag time before the lightning strikes. So I'm just going to trim it down here by saying the play start is going to be at 10% in, so it hits right when that thunderbolt is, and reduce the play length to 90%, which is going to cut out that sound of silence, the silent bit, at the beginning. So now when I hit the A key, we get the lightning right away. That's all there is to it. So while using the enter scene trigger and the keyboard watcher might seem very simple on the surface, many Isadora actors have these trigger inputs and outputs built into them. You can always recognize them by actors that have a dash instead of a number or a word or phrase or GPU or video input on them. Whenever you see that little dash on an input or output, that means that input or output is ready to receive a trigger from something like the enter scene trigger or the keyboard watcher. You can watch the triggers very, very carefully because you'll notice that they have a small X appear on them, just like that, whenever they are triggered. And you can think of them just like a button being pressed, on or off, start or stop, fire that trigger. By using the keyboard watcher and the enter scene trigger and all the other types of actors that can fire triggers, you can create some really precise controls in Isadora, from beautiful soundscapes to even very powerful interactive works. This is just an introductory basics of how to get going with this, but in the coming tutorials, we're going to explore a lot more how we can use these trigger actors to very, very powerful effect. Well, that wraps it up for this tutorial. We're going to be exploring a lot more about how to make the most of trigger actors in our future Isadora 101 segments. So be sure to find those right here on YouTube. You can also find plenty more resources for how to use Isadora on the Troikatronix website. While you're there, be sure to stop by the Troikatronix Community Forum, which is a great place with tons of resources shared by Isadora users worldwide. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you at the next workshop.